Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks. I'm Kate Lewis. It's been a while since I've been here with you, but it's good to be back, and especially on this Feast of the Transfiguration. And to think more about that and talk about this together, let me offer you this. You see what it is?
Twinkies.
It's Twinkies. Well, what do we know about Twinkies? Well, if you're into sweets, they are really good. And they last a really, really long time. Right? We know the joke about the shelf life of Twinkies. Twinkies are reliable. Every one you have ever eaten or ever will eat will taste and look and feel exactly the same. There are no surprises with a Twinkie. Tomato. It has been a great year for tomatoes. This one is from my garden. I'm pretty proud of it. And what do we know about tomatoes?
They're acidic.
Yep. Each one is different. They don't taste the same. You never quite really know what you're going to get in a tomato until you open it up. It could be acidic or tangy or warm or rich. They're all pretty different. And there's another thing about tomatoes, which is they don't last forever. They come ripe in the summer, and unless you cook them or freeze them, you've got to eat them when they're ready. They are not on your time. You're on their time. And then there's the sadness that some years they don't grow at all. You can never be sure about tomatoes. Twinkie, man-made, predictable, wrapped up and protected by cardboard and plastic. Tomato, God-made. Unpredictable, temporal, vulnerable. This does connect with Transfiguration. And that's through our old friend St. Peter. Simon Peter was one of the first disciples that Jesus called. You know, he was part of that inner circle. He was always the eager one, always trying to understand things and get it right. He's the only one who jumped out of the boat to get to Jesus as he was walking across those stormy seas. He's also the only one who followed Jesus through the streets of Jerusalem as he was walking to his death. Painfully, Peter was the one who, sure enough, just as Jesus predicted, denied him three times before that night was over. And Peter was also the one whom Jesus, after he had risen and met them ahead on the beach in Galilee, gave the healing opportunity to answer three times yes to the question, "Do you love me?" And Peter is the one we find today up on the mountain who wants to get it right and hang on tight. This is amazing. Let's make three booths so you can stay. Let's put this in a plastic wrapper and save it forever. Don't fault Peter for going the Twinkie route. Our desire to control our environment, be certain about our values, it's perfectly human. And that desire to control is also perfectly necessary in the first part of our lives. But there comes a time, usually around midlife, when discovering that we are not in control situates us more correctly in God's universe. That discovering we are not in control situates us more correctly in God's universe. Because by then, we've lived enough and failed enough and lost enough to realize that life is not predictable or even sensible. And in our quiet grief about that, we come to see how all the while it's been illusion. We've not really been in control. We've not been on our own. But we've been led, used, guided by God. And paradoxically, The discovery of this smallness and failure is what brings extraordinary freedom and peace. I'm personally coming to know this. It has taken a while, but I'm coming to understand this paradoxical truth on a real visceral level. The change is happening for me, and it's like this particular red ripe tomato and its particular promise of goodness. It's not something I can hold on to and keep. It's not something that's going to be the same every time. And it's something I just have to wait for, receive, and enjoy in the moment. My Monday through Friday work is as a hospital chaplain at St. John's Hospitals in Oxnard and Camarillo. And I have a patient right now on our hospice unit who's young. He's in his 40s, but he's dying of cancer. His mother is a gem, and she's been staying at the hospital day and night. We've made her as comfortable as we possibly can. But it's getting hard because her son has been in his last coma in this actively dying stage for 10 days already. That is a very, very long time for that process. And the other day I was talking with his mom and I ventured to ask her something. I asked her how she was feeling about that. If she was sort of maybe on one hand kind of hoping he would go ahead and go quickly, or if perhaps she was hoping he would last longer so she could hold on to every precious second of his life. And I hope I never forget her answer, because she really thought for a moment about what I'd asked, and then she said, you know, honestly, neither one of those things. Because I know it's not up to me. I know that he and God are having a conversation, and they will decide when the time is right, and I'll accept whatever comes. She started to cry a bit about that, but then she very quickly refound her center, and she said, you know, I don't really have a say in any of this, and somehow that makes me feel better. She was right. What had happened for her is that she had come to accept her powerlessness, and in doing so, she'd become free. This is the paradox of the Christ. This is the folly of the cross, that we are weak when we are strong, and that when we are small and die to our small selves, we rise into our God selves. When we die to our small selves, we rise to our God selves. And so may I invite you, in your personal lives and in this time of transition here at Epiphany, to consider this choice really seriously. Twinkie or tomato? The illusion of control or the freedom of vulnerability? And let me bring this even closer. In 15 minutes or so, you'll be invited to come to this table and receive Christ's body into your body. And honestly, will you come for the purpose of trying to get control over yourself or control over something in your life? Or might you come to this table with complete unknowing, with sacred smallness, allowing whatever is ripe and ready now to fill you with unknown energy and hope? I don't know. It might be your time. It might be your time for a profound admission of powerlessness, of submission to the hand of God already at work in your life, for the ripening of freedom. There were words in the second lesson we heard today from Peter in his wisdom near the end of his life, saying, "You will do well to be attentive to this, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. You will do well to be attentive to this."